Somebody high five or do something, air five, whatever. Tell them God is good. Y'all know how we do it in the Baptist church. Say God is good. All the time. God is good. All right. So listen, that didn't work quite like I wanted it to, but that's all right. I'm excited about being here to minister today, and just want to thank God for our pastors, Pastor Juan and Pastor Ruthie. They are, let's go show some love for them. Amen. Incredible, incredible, incredible visionaries, incredible pastors. We know that a part of the heart of this church is to help other smaller churches and other ministries grow and develop. And Pastor Juan right now is ministering up in Dallas. And the reason why he's ministering up in Dallas, a church recently lost their pastor. And he went up to just show some love and show some aid as Get Rap does. Amen. So we ask that you be praying for him, and we honor him and just thank God that lives are being changed where he is, and just grateful for all that he does. Amen. Y'all ready for the word this morning? Yes. Amen. We are in our series, That's All Folks. Amen. That's All Folks. And we miss, sometimes we see the big caption, but we miss the little words at the bottom. Say this with me. It is finished. I want to talk to you today from that little phrase, it is finished. But I want to add something on to it. It is finished, but it's still unfinished. It is finished, but it's unfinished. And for those of you who are real religious and been in church all your life, that might offend you. Because in some way, you might say to yourself, it takes ownership out of Jesus' hand and puts it in ours. And it somehow demeans the cross. I'm not in any way trying to demean the cross, but I need for you to understand that this is a statement by Jesus. He is not talking about or freeing us from the ability or the responsibility of doing work. He is not trying to free us from the responsibility of doing work. He is simply making a statement about the finished work of the atonement of the cross. That through the cross, there's full atonement for all of our sins through faith. Amen? So when he says it's finished, we need to understand it is what? Finished. It is finished. Don't try to go out there and drum up what you did yesterday and what you did wrong and how you messed up in this in 1972 and how you did all these things wrong. No, you need to understand it is finished in his eyes. He has already paid the price for every sin that in past, in present, and in future. Say past, present, and future. Tell your neighbor, say I'm covered. Now, understand this is a term called grace. We have grace. It is grace, grace through faith that we are saved. And so it is a grace of God. Not by our works, lest any man should boast. But we are not saved by our works, but the Bible says we are saved unto good works. In other words, what we do does not make us saved, but what we do points to the fact that we are saved. And many of us have developed, Aaron, you might be the only person that agrees with me. I see you shaking your head, okay? Listen to this. Many of us have gotten this lazy attitude as it relates to being a Christian. Okay, if you can't say amen, say ouch. Okay, so we have become slothful, and I'm not talking about just talking about you. I'm talking about me and having to, something God spoke over my life, and I had to get out of it. But we have become slothful Christians, and we are plagued with this mentality that somehow what Jesus did absolves us from doing any work. That somehow, because Christ finished it on the cross, then all of a sudden, all I'm going to do is sing hymns and sing songs and jump around at the altar and pray, and then everything in my life is going to be all right. Some of you need to get up off your knees and go and work. Okay, so when he said it is finished, it is not giving us a pass for a lazy work ethic. What it is saying is he has freed us from the penalty of sin so that now the work that we do is empowered by his presence and his Holy Spirit to have the victory that he wants for us. It's not that our works get us anything, but what it does is he places our victory. I'm all off my notes. He places our victory along the path of obedience, and as we begin to walk that thing out, we meet up with victory after victory after victory. It's not that somehow us working somehow gets us something, but God wants us to be obedient to his will, because Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 says, without faith it is impossible to please God. Okay, let's keep on going. Many of us misunderstand this term and don't realize it's simply about atonement. Let me give you four things that it is finished, the words it is finished brings up. Throw that slide up for me. Four things that you need. First of all, it is finished means that there's full, sufficient, and atonement for man's sin. Let's go to the next one. Number one, four manifestations of Christ's sacrifice. Number one is full and complete forgiveness. Say full and complete. Stop worrying about everybody want to bring up everything you did, when you did it, how you did it, who you did it with. Huh? The blood of Jesus covers everything. And how many of you know, check this out, many of you are thinking about that person that brought up your mess, but many times we bring up our mess more than other people do. And every time we have, where's Carrie at? Carrie, there you go, wave your hand, buddy. Wave your hand in the air. Wave it just like you know. Okay, so check this out. I was having a conversation with Carrie yesterday, and I asked him, how did you overcome this situation that he had in his life? And the one thing he said is, I stopped making excuses for where I was. And many of us have got into this thing where we make excuses about where we are, and it's not that God hadn't forgiven us and hadn't moved us past, but we are still looking back over everything that went wrong. And that's why in your car, how many of you drive a car? You've ever driven a car before? That's why your windshield is bigger than your rear view mirror. Because God has a thought or he wants you to focus more on where you're going than where you... My wife preached that thing last week, so I got to do pretty good to make up for that. Number two, full restoration of relationship. Not only has he forgiven you of your sins, but the Bible says that the enmity between you and God has now been cut off. He ain't mad with you. He ain't upset with you. He might be upset with some behavior that you're doing, but he loves you. And all of what you're going through, see, many of us are always going around and we're giving this false testimony. I'm going through this because God is mad with me. No, he ain't. No, he ain't. He ain't mad with you. You chose that door, and now you're trying to blame it on God. You chose to walk through that door of sin, and now you want to turn around and say, this is God punishing me? No. He said, I set before you blessings and curses, life and death. What? Choose life. You chose death, and then now you want to blame it on God. I have been fully restored. The reality is the blood of Jesus now covers everything about me. And when God sees me, he doesn't even see me anymore. He sees the blood of Jesus. So before God, I'm not even Todd anymore. I'm the Son of God. Hallelujah. Woo, full restoration. Number three, assurance of supernatural victory. I have the assurance of supernatural victory. Why? Because I am in Christ Jesus. And so every time I face a situation, I walk into it with the assurance that everything I face, I'm going to win. Not because I'm good, but greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. I'm not good, but I serve a good God. Huh? And he knows the plans that he has for me. Plans of good, not of evil, to bring me to a hope and a future. David, when he faced Goliath, he said, when Goliath started talking to him and saying, I'm going to cut your head off and feed you to the dogs. He said, I realize you think you know how to prophesy, but let me tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to cut your head off right now, and I'm not going to cut your head off, but the God that I serve, the God that I serve is going to give your head to me on a platter this day. When I go forth in the strength of God, it's not that I'm going and I'm looking at myself and thinking more highly of myself than I ought, but I know I got a God that's with me that's able to do exceeding abundantly above. Oh, okay. Woo! Number four. Now, not only does it give me complete forgiveness and full forgiveness, it gives me full restoration of relationship, assurance of supernatural victory. Here's the thing that many of us miss. It also introduces me into relational responsibility to walk out the victory through obedience. What does that mean? That's a whole lot of words that means when Jesus said it is finished, he had a baton in his hand and reached out and said, take it and run. In other words, he didn't just say it's finished for you to sit on your rusty dusty and think that I can pray and all of it's going to come out of the air. No, I got to get up and do something. Tell your neighbor, say, do something. So there's a relational responsibility. How many married folks in the house? Any married folks in the house? Okay, let me ask you a question. What if in your marriage one spouse was giving everything and doing everything and providing everything and striving to make the marriage work, but the other one didn't? Huh? We would have some serious problems. Don't say that in front of your husband. Help, Lord. Jesus, him, right here, Jesus, right here. Now, what if you're doing everything and the person, the husband or the wife was the one that was doing nothing? That wouldn't be much of a relationship. A relationship is reciprocal. It is one where you give and they give, and y'all are outdoing each other in the giving. You're trying to outdo each other in the loving. And that's the same way it is with God. We make God out to be some sugar daddy that gives us everything, and we don't never want to do nothing. No, God, I love you. And I'm not loving you because I'm trying to get something from you. I just love you. I want to kiss your feet today. I want to let you know I'm in love with you today. And so I do what I do. All right, go ahead. Let's go. Okay. Woo, I got excited for a minute. Okay. So here we are. Here we are. So I want you to go to Philippians chapter 2 for me. Woo. I'm going to need all my 28 minutes. So, okay. All right, I just want to let y'all know. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12, it says, therefore, my dear friends, just as you have always obeyed. This is Paul. This is Paul talking to the church at Philippi. I'm trying to move out of the way so y'all can see. Therefore, dear friends, just as I have, as you have always obeyed. Say, obeyed. So now, not only in my presence, but even in my absence, work out. Say, work out. Work out your own salvation through fear and trembling. So Paul says in this moment, listen to this. He says, I know y'all act right when pastor is all around. I know you act right when I'm around. And I know you act right when it's when Pastor Greg walks up on the scene, because you're trying to make it look good to him or to Pastor Juan, because you're looking for man's approval. And God says, stop worrying about man and start worrying about me. He said, whenever you get to the place where you're wanting to walk and live and work and do the things of God, transcends who's around you and notices who's up here, that your faith has to become more than just trying to please people. But it has to be because I want to please God. He says, now, even when I'm outside of your presence, you're working out. Say, working out. You're working out your soul salvation What does the word work mean? Work, that's what it means. It means work. It means that in the Greek. It means that in the Hebrew. It means that in English. It means it in Spanish. It means it in Swahili. It means work. So it says work out your soul's salvation. Now, I know I'm hitting a lot of religious folk now because they're saying, I'm already saved. I ain't got to work out nothing. Let me tell you what this really means. It doesn't mean work for your salvation. It says work from your salvation. So what happens is when it tells you to work out your soul's salvation, once you give your life to Christ, you're already saved. You're already saved. But Paul said, as you have received Christ, now walk in him. Most of us have received, a lot of us have received Christ, but we don't walk like we got Christ. And so our talk is different. We can talk, we can do all that. We know how to practice that. But then we get out there in the street and we go to cussing. Somebody cuts us off in the line and then all of a sudden we want to fight. And then we want to blame it on, well, God is still working on me. He sure is. So here it is. We got to walk like it. Out of this place of salvation, we ought to rise up and say, God, I love you. I love you so much. I'm not, there's a line I'm not going to cross. Huh? Ooh. So, where am I on my notes? Where am I? That's okay. Philippians. My stuff almost fell off. Y'all didn't see that. Okay. So in that now work is now equated. Stay right there. Work is now equated to obedience. He says the work is being obedient. So the work is not just the labor of your hand, but it's when God asks you to do something, I'm obedient to what he asked me to do. Even if I don't understand it. Even if I don't know why he's asking me. Even if it offends my flesh. Sometimes God will offend your flesh to save your soul. So Paul says, be obedient. Say, be obedient. Relational responsibility, most people want a one-sided relationship. And God says, I need you to enter into this partnership with me. And I need you to have some expectations on your life that you're not just expecting something from me, but you're expecting something from yourself. Okay. Romans, go to Romans chapter 12, verse 1. This is in the NLT. I'm too tall for this thing. Huh. We need that big church, that real big church where the screen is up real high. Okay. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. He said, that's why you work. Give everything you got to God because of everything he's done. Huh? In the King James, it says, in view of the mercies of God, in view of the cross, in view of the mercy that happened on the cross, you should have died, but you didn't. He did. In view of the mercies to present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable act of service and worship. The NLT says, for all he has done, let them be a living, let them, your body, be a living sacrifice, holy, the kind he will find acceptable. A lot of us are living, I'm throwing us, U.S., you and me. A lot of us are living lives that are unacceptable to God. And I know that ain't something that we want to hear. But you have to learn to recognize, Carrie, thank you for. We have to learn how to recognize when the situations we in are not because God put us in there, it's because we walked outside of the will of God and make some changes. Because God gives us the ability to shift. That's what the word repent means. Repent doesn't mean just changing behavior, it means change of mind. So this is, say this last verse, this last sentence with me. Okay, right here. Boom. Boom. Home run. Check this out. This is truly what worship is. Because early in Scripture, in Genesis, I think it is in chapter 22, Abraham is going to sacrifice his son Isaac. And when he's going to sacrifice his son Isaac, the Bible says he sees the very place where he's supposed to go. Now, you have to understand, he's been waiting on this child for over 50 plus years. And now God has called him to sacrifice it. He turns to his people and he said, yeah, listen to this. Y'all go over there with the donkeys. Hang out with the donkeys. You need to tell some folks that are slow as donkeys, go over there with the donkeys. Trying to talk you out of what God wants you to do. Stay with the donkeys, with the crap and the mess. Stay with the donkeys. While me and the lad go over here and worship. He wasn't going to sing songs. He wasn't going to pray. He was going to be obedient. Jacob, true worship is not just about you shamalama-ding-donging at the altar. True worship is when God says do something, you do it. When God says sacrifice something, you sacrifice it. When God says go here, you go. When God says go there, you go. And that's what worship is. Okay. I'm going to get y'all in a second. Okay, so now, walking by faith becomes more than just a belief system. It becomes an exercise of worship in which we reverently honor God with every step of our obedience. As I walk in obedience of what he asked me to do, now faith becomes the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Hebrews 11 and 1, say it with me. Now faith becomes the substance of things hoped for. So what is hope? What is faith? Faith is not a belief system. Faith is the substance of your belief system. Faith is the thing that you're doing that points to what you believe. If you're not doing anything in tandem with what you believe, then you don't have faith. Huh? We dealt with Pastor Juan preached about Noah. Noah believed God that it was going to rain. So what did he do? He started building the ark. When we look at Hebrews 11 and we look at the Hall of Fame of Faith, every supernatural occurrence that happened with those people of faith happened after they did something. Most of us are talking about I'm believing God for my finances to come around, but you're still taking out the credit card. Huh? You ain't went to get no help. Carrie, you repair credit. Yeah. Go to Carrie. Huh? Find some folks. Listen, right now, my wife and I left jobs and to come to ministry. And you know what I've done? I've gone into Pastor Greg's office. He's good with finances, run his own business. You know what I said? Pastor, I need you to teach me about some finances. I don't care how much I pray for God to send me more finances. If I don't do something, Hallelujah. So here it is. I got 18 minutes. Okay, all right. So it's the walk out of predetermined victory. Faith is the walking out of a predetermined victory. So this is what happens. So I'm walking, right? I'm living our life. God, I believe in you. I'm believing you. And what God does is he tells you, you already have victory. Well, I believe you. But just because I have victory, I may not possess it in my hand. And so what God does is he says, I'm thirsty, right? God, I'm believing you for water. So God says, okay, I'm going to put water right here. I'm going to put challenges in front of you. And here's faith. Faith is not saying, God, I'm believing you for water, and now I'm finna levitate the bottle. That's what many of us are doing. We're trying to levitate something that God has already empowered me and my legs to go and get. See, I can sit here all day and say, I got faith for that water. I got faith for that water. Come, water, come, come. That water gonna sit right there. Because what happens is God says, I gave you two legs. Get your big butt up and walk over there. Pick up the water. Open up the top. There are some things I have to do. Okay, check this out. Suppose you missed it. When Moses comes to the Red Sea, right? When Moses comes to the Red Sea and he's believing God to be delivered from Pharaoh, he comes to the Red Sea and God asks him the question, why are you crying to me? Go and read it. He says, why are you crying? Lift up your staff, lift up your hand. The staff was a natural thing he had in his hand before he ever met God. And God said, lift that up first. Before you start praying, before you do all that, lift up the natural thing you have in your hand. What are the natural things that you know to do? You want a job? Go get cleaned up, cut your hair, pull up your pants. Oh, come on now. Pastor Greg will testify with me. Pastor Michelle, they'll testify with me. We have what's that right next to us? Job placement place. And it amazes me, the jokers, to come up in there for a job. One dude the other day, he walked up in there. Listen, I'm telling you, he was so dirty. And then, listen to this, took off his shoe in the midst of it and started messing with his toes. Are you serious, bro? You want a job. Do everything you can in the natural and then trust God. Okay, y'all. Okay. This might not be a shouting sermon today. So now we have been empowered. Say, we have been empowered. What a victory along obedience. So what does that look like? I'm glad you asked. Go to Romans chapter 1, verse 16 through 17. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 through 17. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. This is Paul. Y'all know I love Paul. Because it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. He didn't say salvation came to everyone that does everything right. He says to the one that believes. But believes is tied up in what you do. First to the Jew and then to the Greek or the Gentile. Verse 17. This is where we're going to hang our hat. Verse 17 says, for in the righteousness, in it, the righteousness of God. What is it? Huh? The gospel. For in the gospel is the righteousness of God revealed from, say it with me, faith. To, faith. Say it again, faith to faith. Say it again. One more time. This is so good. Just because it is written, the just shall live by faith. Now, it says the word lives by faith. This is the process by which we live. We live by faith. When do you need faith? You say all the time, but I don't need much faith to walk over there and give Richard a hug. Because I believe I can do it. I've done it before. So it doesn't take much faith to do that. But faith is exhibited when something arises that you can't handle. See, everybody who only judges their faith when anything is right and everything is right, that ain't really faith. You're just rolling off momentum. Faith is, mama, testify when you get a diagnosis of cancer. Faith is when you have to face things that you can't handle on yourself. Sometimes God will allow things. I'm not saying he brings cancer or he brings negative situations, but he will allow things that you just can't do. That's why he calls it supernatural. He lends his super to your, okay. Ooh. So here it is. And he says that this gospel of righteousness, this gospel in it, the gospel, the righteousness of God. Righteousness means right standing with God. So when I understand the gospel and what he has done, I gain right standing through knowing and believing what Jesus has done. The finished work of the cross. And that finished work is revealed from faith to faith. Say it again. Faith. This is why we got to study. This is why we got to study. Because faith to faith means that there's one challenge. Y'all remember David, Pastor David Vestal came and said, everything that's healthy, what? Grows. Everything that grows, what? Deals with challenges. Everything that has challenges gives us another opportunity to trust God. That's what faith is. Because whenever I have faith, it's because I'm dealing with a challenge in my life that I have to face head on and overcome. But it says from faith to faith. So at the moment I overcome one challenge, I'm ready for a... This is a line of talking that Christians don't like to hear. Because we want everything to be pie in the sky. But you are living from one challenge to the next. And it's through the righteousness of God, the goodness of God, that brings you through one challenge that you face. All right, go to the next slide. Go to the next slide. I'm going to bring it home on this one. So this is called the cycle of faith. Cycle of faith. We have faith. God says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, without faith, it is what? Impossible to please God. So if faith comes in the face of challenges and it's impossible to please God without challenges, you have to know that sometimes the things that we go through are not just works of the devil, but ordered by God. Okay, I ain't get enough amens for that. Oh, he preaching heresy. Let me bring Jesus in here to testify. Let me bring Jesus in here. Because the Bible says, full of the Spirit, Jesus was led by the Spirit into the desert to be tempted of the devil day and night for 40 days. Sometimes, but here's the thing. Sometimes God will allow you to go through the circumstances you go through because the Bible says, in that first verse it said, full of the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit into the desert. But when you get on down to verse 15, it says, now Jesus, in the power of the Holy Ghost, returned to Capernaum. So what happens is, what the devil meant for evil, God meant it for good. God allowed him to be tempted for 40 days and for 40 nights. We would get discouraged and hang our heads, but we didn't realize that the problem was not to kill him, but was a workout for the power that was coming. So the cycle of faith. So here it is. Where do you have to have faith? You have to first have faith. Christian, you have to have faith in the possession of it. There's going to come up in your spirit. There's something that you want. There's something. How many of you are dealing with something that you desire from God right now? That you're needing God. You're needing God to, well, here's what's going to happen. Here's what's going to happen. Y'all need to testify. Here's what's going to happen. Here it is. You're going to go after it with everything in you. And then all of a sudden, you're going to possess it. But when we possess it, listen to this. Sometimes what we possess is not what we actually wanted. Because you asked for an oak tree and God gave you an acorn. You wanted an oak tree and God said, okay, here it is. Because many times when God gives you something, he gives you something in seed form. So what happens is God has an expectation when he gives it to you that now that you have possessed the acorn, now go and plant it. Go and do some work. And so my faith has, if I have faith in God, now what I have to do is have faith that I do the work, I plant it, I water it, I cultivate it, and then you start seeing the plant come up. Now, so that is the progression. So I had faith to possess it. Now I have to have faith through the process or the progression of it. In other words, there's some things I not only had to walk in faith to get it, but now I have to walk in faith to keep it. What you do to get the victory, you do to keep the victory. Amen. See, can I tell y'all something about marriage? Most marriages fail is because when you was dating her, you did everything. Huh? You would stay up to 2 o'clock in the morning. You would literally go anywhere and everywhere. Baby, come over here. It's three in the morning. Come on anyway. Okay, I'm coming. You did everything. You bought everything. You spent all your money on her. You treated her nice. And as soon as you got married, you stopped loving her. Like, okay. So faith is a, you have to have faith in the possession. You have to have faith in the progression. Now you have to have faith in the promotion. Because see, once God gives it to you, once you water it, once you get to the promotion, now you have to have integrity to keep it. Huh? So the work is not necessarily the physical work, but now it is the work to stay in the word and to live in the promotion, the platform that he gives you in the way that he wants you to live. Because you get on the platform, your gift will bring you before great men. Your integrity will keep you there. Lastly, now, once I have gotten the possession of it, once I have gone through the progression, once I have gotten the platform, now God says, I expect you to live from faith. At that moment, you have to have enough faith that I don't just rest on what I accomplished yesterday, but I'm before your face, God. What do you want me to do today? Give me this day my daily bread. Huh? I want to hear your heart today. And most of us have gotten caught up and we live off yesterday's manna. You got one scripture and all of a sudden that carried you through a month, but now you ain't studying no more. You ain't praying no more. And God says, I got to trust you not just in the promotion, but in the petition for the next level. What, God, do you want? And God, I'm yours anyway. Huh? So if you cause me to go to another cross, if you cause me, you come on now. You come on. Where is Santi? If you cause me to go through the struggle, I'm ready for the next. Because my faith is not about comfort. See, most Christians, their faith is about comfort. The only reason some of us give our lives to Christ is because we want it to all be better. Well, you might as well have stayed in the world. Because listen to this. Sometimes you have to fight through. Huh? But it requires us. There's a requirement. And that's why some people ask why I work so hard. That's why. Because it's an indication, not that I'm trying to get something, but what God has already promised me I'm coming to. Huh? That's why I get up. Huh? Huh? Pastor asked me in my oversight the other day, he said, how many hours you work this week? I said, oh, about 55 or 60. About 55 or 60. He looked at me. Stephanie be telling me, you need to go home, Pastor Todd. You need to go home. And I get it. I'm not trying to be an unhealthy person. I'm not trying to work for my salvation. But sometimes, at my office, if anybody's been to my office, I got right here my daughter, Tyra. I got my wife, my queen. I got my son, the last male in my family that will take on the name Hopes. Then I got my baby girl over here. My wife got up here, is preaching last week. My oldest daughter is about to get a degree from Prairie View. My youngest daughter is at Texas Tech and doing well. And when I think about the goodness, used to do, and I'm saved. If I die today, I know that I'm going to hear him say, well done. don't work, God, because I'm trying to get something from you. I'm working because I just want to say, God, I'm grateful. I work because I want to tell you that I'm thankful. So I want to arrest this lazy spirit. Because everything you do, this is in response to what you know you already have. Every time I go the extra mile, it's just me trying to say I love you, Lord. Stop right quick. There's a song. Oh no, I'm gonna mess it up. But it says, I love you, Lord, and I live, sing it, my voice to rejoice, take joy, my King. Come on, come on. And while you that's why I work.
Amen. Why don't you guys-